It's the end of an era. After years of contentious debates, Germany has shut down its last three remaining nuclear power plants. Is closing these plants in Germany a good decision?
It is a bad decision, and it's out of step with Germany's trading partners and allies, not just in Europe, but around the world. It's a small nation's worth of energy that's being turned off today, energy that could power tens of millions of people in developing countries or 5 million Germans. It's the cheapest energy Germany's got, so it's a fairly catastrophic decision, especially considering this energy works round the clock all year, not just when the weather's right.
The actual electricity generation, not just capacity, by planned renewables next year corresponds to the output of the three nuclear power plants closed. Germany is on track. Germany said it would stop nuclear. Germany said it would go renewables. And this is essentially what's happening. The same is true for the coal burn. The coal burn is diminishing stepwise.
Germany will be paying about four times as much for only the carbon permits alone per unit of electricity, plus another double or so cost for its own lignite coal burning. That's what it's replacing lost nuclear with. And then only slowly over time is it planning to add in the renewables to replace, if that works. The renewables expansion has been planned a certain way, but we do not know if Germans will tolerate the further construction of wind turbines, counting future weather and climate-based energy as for sure going to come and replace the nuclear electricity that is lost and being replaced by the coal electricity. Now, for Germany to be hogging, by choice, carbon emission trading permits, that means that poorer countries in Europe will not be able to feed their industries, will not be able to power their businesses, because Germany is buying the fossil fuels and the carbon permits with its wealth levels that are higher than surrounding nations.
Nuclear is just far too expensive. And critically, in terms of our climate problems, it's just too late. It takes up to 20 years to put down one nuclear station. We simply do not have the time. We do not have the capacity for new nuclear. The only option, our only option, is indeed renewables. And if you want to look at sort of another example in terms of France, German power exports to France jumped last year, largely because half of France's nuclear capacity was offline. Despite all of the nuclear PR in terms of France, EDF are essentially bankrupt. There's no question it will be too late for climate. And there's no question but that renewables will do the heavy lifting for net zero. That's not rhetoric. That's not me that's saying that. It's just simply a fact.
I agree with Dr. Dorfman that the French fleet was performing poorly, but that just underscores the German nuclear fleet that is closing today is the envy of the world. They're the three finest reactors in the world, producing the most electricity, ultra high reliability. The German nuclear plants operate so well that it takes 10 times as much solar panels capacity to match what nuclear does per gigawatt. It's an astonishing number. And the fact that we have to cite countries that are stating they will become nuclear focused in the future, like France. France is moving towards nuclear, yet it's Germany whose nuclear plants are already built today, not in 20 years, like Dr. Dorfman said. Nuclear plants are ready today in Germany. They don't need upgrades. They don't need fixing. They're ready today to provide the cheapest, stablest energy for 12 million Germans. So to change the subject to a nuclear fleet that isn't working well is to miss the fact that it's the German nuclear fleet that's the outstanding backbone of energy for Europe during the winter.
Paul, you wrote a piece last year in which you said it's not just that nuclear is slow and expensive, it's just far too inflexible to go up and down with the swings of demand. Why is that the case?
It doesn't, what's known as load follow, it doesn't sort of do this well to back up variable renewables. There are answers to variable renewables in terms of storage, in terms of demand-side management, in terms of interconnection, in terms of distributed grids. Now, given the fact, and it is a fact, that renewables will do the heavy lifting for net zero, the last thing that you want to back that up with is nuclear, because nuclear goes and runs. It's uneconomic if it doesn't do that. The very last thing that you want to back up the variability of renewables is nuclear.
Nuclear plants have excellent ability to go up and down. I mean, for one, it would be a basic safety requirement. So nuclear plants can and do operate in load following mode. Now, there's no reason that the nuclear plant should do more load following just because some weather-based energy gets more subsidies. That's maybe good for the owners of the wind and solar plant, but it does not make economic good sense for the country as a whole. So Germany's about to discover that, of course, that they're going to back up their wind and solar with hard coal and lignite coal instead of the ultra-cheap nuclear they had. That seems to be an error, but make no mistake, it's not a physical limitation from nuclear to have to move up and down. It's not a problem. Once young people and old people get curious about nuclear and investigate, they find that what they've heard is untrue and they demand more nuclear power. That's why you see countries around Europe planning nuclear programs now, including multiple countries on the border with Germany, have plans to add nuclear today.
There's a lot of discourse for nuclear because nuclear is a very strong lobby in all kinds of problematic ways. The head of the IAEA, which is the Nuclear Regulator International, says that we are now living on borrowed time in terms of Zaporizhzhia. In a world that's becoming increasingly unstable, to have these targets is deeply problematic. Now, in terms of Fukushima, what we've seen is that even in an advanced state, the consequences of a real nuclear accident can be catastrophic. And I remember after speaking in the same platform as Naoto Kan, who was the Prime Minister of Japan at the same time, we had supper afterwards, and being astonished when he turned to me and said, if the wind was in the wrong direction, we would have lost Tokyo.
All of the G7 except for Germany are committed to nuclear energy, especially Japan. The voters of Japan democratically chose, time after time, the most pro-nuclear candidate possible. That mandate has given the government in Japan desire to repeatedly announce expansions of its ambitions in nuclear energy, not just restarting reactors that have been closed since the disaster at Fukushima Daiichi, but adding more. There's a reason why the countries where the great nuclear disasters have occurred have learned to not be afraid of nuclear. For example, in Ukraine, the reactors at Zaporizhzhia nuclear plant are all turned off. The heat level is low. It means that a Fukushima-type disaster is simply not in the cards. But the engineering message has not gotten out, quite to the contrary of Dr. Dorfman's claim that the atomic lobby is powerful. The nuclear industry is almost completely incapable of talking plainly and clearly to the public. I am on this program in part because nuclear employees are not allowed to talk to the press almost anywhere in the world. The nuclear lobby in Germany was paid off by the government to stay silent, and they were not present today, and they scarcely speak to the media. That's quite to the opposite of the claims that some nuclear lobby is powerful. Rather, it's people getting involved, volunteering their time and speaking up, which is the reason why young people around the world are turning in the same directions as the G7, except for Germany, which is a commitment to nuclear.
It's difficult to know what to say. I mean, aside from essentially PR, It's difficult to understand why there's so much discussion about nuclear in terms of policy and press at the moment. Nuclear is basically a 20th century technology. It's past its sell-by date. The future is renewable.
All right. Well, we have run out of time, so we're going to have to leave the conversation there. You can see the program again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com.